Kommilitoninnen und Kommilitonen. This was a traditional way to address students all over the Coimbra group in the Middle Ages. And this indicates that we are all somewhere together searching the truth. That was the original idea. And of course, during the Middle Ages, we know that from all the debates about theologists, there were a lot of disputes. And that was one of the major points of our European traditions, that there are disputes. Some even were not accepted by the Catholic Church later on. But this was a major effort to really create some kind of understanding, and it made, I think, and we can be proud about this, it made Europe a continent of really trying to find more beyond traditional beliefs. Narratives. We heard already narratives about the Cologne University, about the Coimbra group. Where are we coming from and where are we going to? My starting point is, of course, why are you here? Normally I would ask you and go around and point my fingers at some of you, but unfortunately I was asked to stay in this area, so let's say my freedom of movement is limited. So why do you think it's important to talk about narratives? What is it all about? And we come perhaps back at that at the end of my lecture. I would like to start first looking at my title, Jean Monnet. What is behind Jean Monnet narrative? I would like to ask you, but again, this is technically a little bit more problematic to get answers from you. If you Google Jean Monnet, you might find a French cognac. And that's not by coincidence, because Jean Monnet was the son of a French cognac producer who, before the First World War, the father thought it's good to send the son to sell the cognac in the Anglo-Saxon world. When the First World War broke out, he changed, let's say, his profession by trying to recommend to the British and French troops not only to look for military cooperation, but also for economic cooperation. He did that the same in the Second World War, and then he became one of the leading figures in the French economy, the Commissariat au Plan, which were, by the way, not liked by the German economists. They always thought it's too much planification. They didn't like that idea. And then he became what is sometimes called the arch saint of European integration. And I think that's important for our subject. He became the first honorary citizen of Europe, a title which is given by the European Council. And I would like to ask our French colleague, where do you think he is buried? In which place is he buried? You don't know? He is in the Pantheon. That's in Paris, and for those who understand French, aux grands hommes, la patrie reconnaissante. For the great names, the fatherland or motherland in good faith or in gratitude. So he's both, and that's my narrative start. He's both a good European and a good French person. This is signified by this. And I think that's very important for our narratives to see. Now, of course, we know that the question is, what are narratives? I think Camilla already indicated quite well the point that they are somewhere constructed. And as you see, I use the 12 stars, a symbol to which I return a little bit later, to make certain kind of definitions. And it also is in social science. I don't know about the physicists, if they also have. There is no master definition of narratives. You know, there are a lot of different ways to look at that. At the first moment, you think it's just a story which you tell. You can read it, yeah. A story which you can tell about yourself, where you are coming from, where you're going to. But we take it more serious in saying it's framing our understanding. It develops certain concepts in which we think, from which we think. And then it comes, and that's very near to what Herr Müller just told us from historians, social constructivism, which is one of the more fashionable ways of social science in the last decades, says there is nothing real in reality, it's all in our imagination, our thinking. And we construct realities, we construct histories, I think you mentioned that, in social contexts. So narratives are constructed for example, and especially in our case, within what we call nation states. Yeah? They are, let's say, parts of our understanding where nations are coming from and where they are going to. And that's one of the whole very interesting parts. If I look around, for example, what is similar for the Irish way, Irish narrative on European Union, to the Croatian way, or to the Polish way, and to the Portuguese. And that's already one of the interesting puzzles which we are trying to identify. Where are something in common? And I return to that a couple of times. So social constructivism, for those who want to look at that, you'll find quite a lot of literature trying to deal how, let's say, people are constructing realities. We look at the history, at the present and the future, and as Müller already indicated clearly, the history is not God-given there, but it's always interpreting. And we know, for example, in the 19th century, we quite a lot created our ancestors. In Germany, suddenly, a Saxonian tribe head became the first Germans because he beat the Romans in a battle. You even don't know where the battle really took place till today. But that became the first German. And the French thought out that their Clodwig, I don't know how you pronounce him in French, in the 5th century became the first French king. He didn't have any idea what France is, and what is, but he became the, let's say, patron of this. And you find that in all European states, and I would guess in states outside Europe too. Very interesting for me is how the Americans construct their history, because the history is shorter. But I think they are very much history oriented. If you go to Washington, you see a lot of these monuments which try to explain how the nation, the US nation, came all about. So one of the issues which is dealing is identity. Yeah. What are we? Who are we? That's a famous terminology of Huntington. You might know him. That's the Clash of Civilization, who in his final years wrote a book about the US nation. Who are we? And he was a little bit worried about, let's say, that there are too many people Spanish, speaking Spanish in the US streets. Yeah. The French, by the way, Brodel, leading French historian, wrote also at its end, L'identité de la France. Where is France coming from? And it started 20,000 years before Christ with the paintings in the caves, you know, and trying to find out what are, let's say, their traces which are important to today. Identity, therefore, symbols are quite often related to that. And we, of course, have one symbol which we see each day. That's our euro. And you will see, unfortunately, I don't have this painting. You see the bridge, which is one of these ideas of Europe. You see the continent, the map. I can return to that in 2 minutes. And you find signatures in that. So you'll find that we see each day a European symbol when we are looking into our wallet. And if you drive a car or a bicycle, you see always at the cars back there, there is also the European flag, the 12 yellow stars. So symbols are used quite often. They lead to what you might call mental maps. I like this term because it's the geography. Where are we coming from? Where are we going to? Where are there major changes in our road? Where are critical junctures? Let's say for the Germans, it's quite clear 45. Yeah? We talk about the hour zero. I don't know if this is historically well done, but let's say that this certainly created a certain change of our narratives, at least of our master narratives, I have to say, and to return to the term a little bit later. So mental maps, imagined communities, this is the imagined history, that we develop certain community. We saw that by the Coimbra group, you know, they create a community, they imagine a community based on certain common features, but it's still imagined. It's not God-given since the beginning of the world. Imagined communities, a term which is one of the few German words in English and outside English, the Zeitgeist. I don't know how you translate it, really, the Zeitgeist. Yeah? So it's very much coined by the feeling of the day, yeah, by the moods of the day. And narratives are created or influenced or interpreted by the mood of the day, the Zeitgeist. Now we come to more of our political scientists, especially interested, the master narratives. That you have quite often these master narratives For example, the basic point is that European integration in general is good for Germany. Yeah, that's, let's say, after 45, a general point, which is now more and more disputed, but let's say that would be a master narrative, and I come back to where we find the master narrative in a couple of minutes. The point for political scientists is then, are there hegemonic narratives, and who imposes master narratives? Who are those people who create master narratives? Because that's a general question of political science. Who has the power? Power is a normal phenomenon of our life. And the rector has a power about me, at least when I was still professor here. He could order me to give points, of course, in a good sense. I think that there is nothing which I wouldn't do in any case, but power is a normal phenomenon. And the question is, of course, what is the power and who has the power to create master narratives or even hegemonic narratives? The term comes from a neo-Marxist, Gramsci, an Italian, who was very important in the post-war period in Italy, because he said much more than just the question of Marxism in terms of who owns which kind of production factors. It's important who controls the mental maps of people. So let's say the hegemonic narratives became a very important terminology. I think it's today. Who defines, for example, what should be the Eurogroup's work? Is it stabilization more or help to those who are in trouble? A very important part to study who controls the construction of narratives. Now, and that was one of the starting questions, why are you here? What are narratives all about? And my point is narratives, of course, do not determine necessary action. Quite often you have rhetorics, you have myths, you have a general debate, and you find out that politicians or others are doing things which are different from what they claim they are pursuing. So narratives are not just that you think if a narrative is developed, this will be also determining the action of a state or of an institution. But it offers quite often opportunities. You can, as politician or as rector or somebody, start from a certain common understanding and use that for a certain action. And it makes also constraints that you cannot violate certain points, at least not without any major costs. You see that in the political campaigns sometimes that people stick to what we call past dependency. It was decided in a certain way, and it coins your or determines your area of freedom and movement. So these are all ways to look at narratives. And I would like to take especially the issue of where are we, let's say, in the European side. Now, I have something in which you recognize, I hope, yeah? You know where this is. This is in front of our main building, Adactus Magnus, who was the intellectual father of Thomas Aquinas, who, again, was the most important theological philosopher or theologian in the Middle Ages. So I think that's a very important part. And I wanted to express a little bit more how the university has developed narrative, but our rector did that already, very good. So where are we coming from? And you see this motto, good ideas since 1388, and this was interrupted. I was happy by our French colleagues that his university was also closed, apparently, because the University of Cologne was closed by French troops who conquered Cologne. Not conquered, they just marched into Cologne. The Rote Funken, for those who know Cologne, were not really the proper army to defend against the revolutionary troops of France. If you look at the narratives of Cologne, the Catholics hate that moment because the French troops destroyed all the Catholic infrastructure. You were not responsible. But indeed, perhaps it was even good because otherwise Cologne might have stayed a middle-aged town and not created. And Cologne, as you know, had become a very industrialized city over the 19th century. So I would have made a little bit more, but we saw also the Coimbra group narrative. This is a good example. You look into the past, you find certain basic values and try to find out how can you do that and pronounce that. So I think that's a concrete example. So why and how European narratives? One point is polities politische Systeme, politische Gemeinschaften, political communities need shared narratives for constructing an identity. This doesn't need necessarily to be a very deep common identity, but somehow, if you live together in some way or other, you need some point of reference to which you are sticking. So I think that's an important part where each community, for each system where you try to work in some way or other together. But especially in European kind, you find differences and divergences and similarities and convergences. Again, we put down certain symbols. Of course, you realize that the most important one is on your left side, the Cologne Cathedral, which is, let's say, our symbol. For those who are not knowing Cologne or the Cologne Carnival, if you go into Cologne Carnival, you realize how important the Cathedral and the Rhine is for our narrative about Cologne as a major town, only rivaled in Carnival by Rio de Janeiro. The others are all secondary order Carnival. So, Cologne, Arc de Triomphe, the Reichstag. A small footnote for the Reichstag, also a narrative already. If you look at the Reichstag, which was the first parliamentary building for Germany during the time of the Kaiser, if you go there, you see it's outside the Brandenburg gate. That means the Kaiser wanted to have the parliamentary assembly not inside Berlin, but outside. Yeah? Now it's all Berlin, but you see already the political symbol which are behind that the Reichstag was not liked by the monarchs. So, why and how European natives? Now I have certain questions to you. Union's aim is to promote peace, its values and well-being of its peoples. Where do you find that? Where do you see that? Unfortunately, my colleague Mansel is not there because he's a lawyer. You will find that in the Article 3.1 of the Treaty on European Union, the TEU. And I will treat you now with the Treaty of the European Union. Why? Because that's a document which is accepted, legitimized by all member states. They all ratified it. That's a common document. And even the Bundesverfassungsgericht, after in its evaluation assessment, its ruling on the treaty, had three quarters of the argument is against accepting that. At the end, they said, yeah, we can just accept them to be compatible with the German constitution, with the with the Grundgesetz. So this is really the common paper, and we have to look at that. So to promote peace, that's a very traditional idea of the post-war period. We say we have the longest period of peace in Europe since centuries. My point in this is we might need to be a little bit critical because I think warlike relations between the countries in Western Europe or in Europe would not be able in any case because of the strong dominance of the American troops. That was outside, let's say, possibilities. But for me, peace is more than just the absence of war. It's how we really work together in the institutions, which is very complex and difficult. And we see that if you are more serious looking at the European Union, I had my students for 30 hours in the bachelor, and at the end they were, that's the general way, they were still confused, but as I say, on a higher level, you know, they were confused, but on a higher level. So it's a very complex way. But let's say that's part of the peace process. It's consensus seeking. Consensus is based on compromises, and compromises create complexity. We know that from all multi-level systems, if you look at the German constitution and the way for example, university systems are financed. This is very complex, I think. So that's not an easy way. So peace is more than just the absence of war. It's a way that we try to deal with our problems together. Its values, I think that's very important. We know that this is being endangered by developments against rule of law in certain countries, Hungary and in Poland, and the well-being of its peoples. That's it's also, let's say, the social economic idea. So I think it's a very important three-pronged program. You will find also something which you might not directly realize its importance. The last word, yeah? If you read it, it peoples. It's plural. Yeah? And it's not the European people, because there are people people who say we have a European people because they are based on the same culture and the same idea. But the treaties always talk about plural. And I think that's a good starting point. What are individual nations thinking? So I stay with the question where this comes from. Perhaps you just read it a moment. Drawing inspiration from the cultural, religious and humanist inheritance of Europe. That's, let's say, looking back. Where are we coming from? From which have developed the universal values of the inviolable and inalienable rights, terrible English, I mean, I have to say, terrible to pronounce it in English, of the human person, freedom, democracy, equality, and the rule of law. So, and it's from the Treaty on the European Union in the preamble. By the way, this was a long debate which was going before because some had the idea of talking, instead of talking of religious, of having God in this, advocatio Dei, that's a Latin word for it. And this was put out by, the, for example, the French, who are, of course, a laicist country. We'll find out that in 2 minutes, who wouldn't like to have God mentioned. By the way, Mrs. Merkel wanted to have God mentioned there, but this was put out. I think the Catholic Church intervened into, that was, by the way, the Constitutional Convention in the debates about it, but they couldn't make it on that point. So, religious humanist inheritance of Europe. This is a very general and very ambiguous definition because we all know that religious was not without wars about religion, and humanist inheritance was sometimes against religion. In the French Revolution, humanists were fighting against all influence of the church. And then come, looking back, a mission into the world, universal values of the inviolable and inalienable rights, human person, freedom, democracy, equality, and the rule of law. We claim that it's universal. And there is a UN declaration from the beginning of the 50s which stress that. But you will find, of course, in the today world that people say, wait a moment, you Europeans might have your tradition, you might be good in stressing that, but please don't impose that on us. We have another tradition, we have another way of looking at societies, etc. So this is a mission. Which again is a little bit this background of, let's say, also of the 19th century, the white man's burden. That was Rudyard Kipling, you know, the Jungle Book, but he had also other points. White man's burden. Am deutschen Wesen soll die Welt genesen. I still have problems to translate that. So from the Germans, everybody should learn. I think that's a shorter phrase. There is this kind of claim that we are more than just let's say people and wanted to make some kind of the best world for ourselves, but we have the idea that we want also the best for the rest of the world. We call that normative power, and we see how difficult it is to pursue. So, and here comes the next one, and again, you will not have seen, that's the preamble of the Charter of Fundamental Rights of the European Union. Already this document is highly interesting, because this was only made part of the treaty in the Lisbon Treaty, that means now 10 years. It was prepared by different declarations. But that's important that the European Union is not just a market, it's not just the euro, it's not just perhaps climate policy and environmental standards. It also thinks it is there to defend certain values and especially fundamental rights. You find that in nearly all constitutions that they start with fundamental rights and that a certain country is there to, or that the political system should serve certain fundamental rights. And you see that the preservation and to develop of these common values, which I mentioned before, and then comes what we think is very important, respecting the diversity of the cultures and the traditions of the peoples of Europe, as well as national identities of the member states and organization of their public authorities at national, regional, and local levels. And you see this kind of tension, you know, at one side, preservation, development of these common values, at the same time stressing their diversity of cultures. And there you find also, I will come back to that, you find also where I found the quote, united in diversity, which is a quote from the Constitutional Treaty as one of the mottos. I'll return to that in 2 minutes. Okay, so on one side common values, on the other side the issue of that there are of course diversity of cultures, traditions. They should not be abolished or run over of the peoples of Europe, again the plural. National identity is a major issue, and we find out what are national identities for this. Have a look at that. So first of all, at the look where you can write criticism about my lecture. Okay. So where is this quote coming from? If you look at the basic point, where is this quote coming from? At least I got, when I made the baccalaureate, the Abitur, I got as a gift the Grundgesetz. It got lost somewhere because I moved a couple of times, and somewhere it was lost. But let's say as political science, of course, I looked at that. That's, wait a moment, see. Article 23 of the Basic Law of the Federal Republic, of das Grundgesetz, and European Union Protection of Basic Rights, Principle of Subsidiarity. You see what is a major narrative down in the documents, in the basic documents, the fundamental documents of the Federal Republic, with a view of establishing a united Europe. What is a united Europe? How do you define it? It's already a difficult point. The Federal Republic of Germany shall participate in the development of the European Union that is committed to democratic social federal principles, to the rule of law, and to the principle of subsidiarity, and that guarantees a level of protection of basic rights essentially comparable to that afforded by the basic law. So let's say you see both the narrative in the sense of what is the aim, but also the preconditions. Why are we think democratic social federal principle, rule of law, principle of subsidiarity, which is a basic principle of the Federal Republic itself, so it's rarely really applied in a proper sense, but that's another issue, and basic rights comparable to afforded by this basic law. So that's, let's say, a basic point of the, and of course here, I asked my French colleague, we put in an English translation. Of course, in French it sounds much better than what you read in English. The language of the Republic is French. The national emblem is tricolor, flag blue and white red. The national anthem is La Marseillaise. The motto of the Republic is freedom, equality and fraternity. We know that. The principle is government of the people, by the people and for the people. I think that's very interesting because that was taken up by one of my colleagues here in Cologne, by the Max Planck Institute, Fritz Scharf, who looked at how far is that really applicable to the European Union. This, by the way, comes from the American tradition, this government of the people, by the people, and for the people. The famous Gettysburg speech during the American Civil War, that was, let's say, mentioned there. I don't know if this was the original formulation. I guess there might be something before. But you see, this is a basic idea and also a narrative of the French understanding of, let's say, their own, includes the language, includes the flag, the colors of the flag, the national anthem, the motto, and, but wait a moment, that's the Constitution du 4 October 58. And now you find something analogous here. The flag of the Union shall be a circle of 12 golden stars on a blue background. The anthem of the Union shall be based on the Ode to Joy from the Ninth Symphony by Ludwig van Beethoven. The motto of the Union shall be United in Diversity. You see the title of my report. The currency of the Union shall be the Euro. Europe Day shall be celebrated on the 9th of May throughout the Union. This was put down in the Constitutional Treaty, which, Monsieur Le Collègue, was refuted by the French in their referendum in 2005. So, in the Lisbon Treaty, you find 90% of this constitutional treaty, but all of this has been kicked out, because it looks too much like a state, a nation. But of course, it's still a very important part, because the flag of the Union, we know it's always used on the motorbike, on our currency, and many other occasions. For example, if you see the Bavarian Prime Minister, to give a talk, official talk, you see three flags, the Bavarian flag, the German flag, and the European flag. And also Macron, if he gives a speech, there's a French flag and the European flag. So the European flag is widely used. Also, I've seen that the university has a European flag and certain days puts it on. So the flag is used still, not firmly confirmed in this. The Ode to the Joy, you all know that, Ninth Symphony, Ludwig van Beethoven, and the text is that of Schiller, and I think that's, I think, known by most of us. The motto was new, united in diversity. The Americans talk about e pluribus unum, from many to one, and we say united in diversity. The currency shall be the euro, and Europe Day shall be celebrated on the 9th of May. The question is, what is the 9th of May? Why is it? That was the 8th of May. At least in Western Europe, it was the 8th of May. For the Russians, it was the 9th of May. No, it's the declaration of the Schuman Declaration, which was linked by Monet, or Monet's inspiration, to start the first community, the European Union for Coal and Steel, which is still one of the basic declarations you should read. So at least the civil servants in the Commission on the 9th of May do not need to work. That's, let's say, at least a step there. And we like to do that with historians, that we have sometimes the 8th of May looking back, end of the First World War, 9th of May looking into the future. I think the coincidence of these dates are artificial, or let's say not really done. But I think that's very important. And this, I think, is still a basic narrative about the European Union, though it's the, let's say, it's the same lines with only with the symbols of the Union Treaty establishing a constitution for Europe. By the way, this is a very interesting text, which more or less is forgotten because the Lisbon Treaty has replaced 80% of it, except for these, let's say, national symbols which look like national symbols. You find treaty establishing a constitution of Europe. In most texts of the Council and the European Parliament, you find, if you look at the table, you find a small one saying treaty, and then you find a smaller line establishing, and a big line constitution for Europe. So they try to stress it's a constitution for Europe. As I said, this was not accepted, and I think it would not have been accepted in Britain, for example, and the Netherlands also voted against it. So you see, there was a narrative behind that to make this European Union state-like, you know, with the same symbols state have. And in the text you find also more, for example, that there was supposed to be a European foreign minister. Now this person or this office is called High Representative of the European Union. So the functions and rules and laws are all the same, but it's just another terminology. Okay. What is that? This is, I don't want to test, Article 88 of the French Constitution. Yeah? The public participants in the European Union consists of states which have freely chosen to exercise jointly, I think that's very important, certain of their powers under the Treaty on the European Union and the Treaty on the Function of the European Union, as derived from the treaty signed in Lisbon on the 13th of November. So, like in the in the Grundgesetz, the French have formulated a certain way to deal with this and to clear. I think the major point here is to have freely chosen to exercise jointly certain of their powers. I think that's very important, jointly. So the national sovereignty, which I think the French like very much, is already limited or shared. Let's say that's shared. And I think that's one of the major narratives in the post-war period. Nation states have given up part of their competences, of their powers to this European Union. We British are as much heirs to the legacy of European culture as any other nation. This is, let's say, interesting in view of the Brexit debate. Who could have been that? Margaret Thatcher. Speech to the College of Europe, September 88. We British are as much heirs to the European legacy of European culture. And she has a long explanation to that, where they are all in. The interesting part, if you read this text, she started by saying, I'm here because I'm called anti-European and nevertheless go into the center of European education. The College of Europe is still a major postgraduate institution for framing and building and constructing certain ideas on Europe. So she went there with the British humor. That was, I think, very important. And then she said, which I still like, how can you build a European Union if Prague, Budapest, Warsaw is not part of that? Look at the date, 88. Yeah, that was before the fall of the Berlin Wall. And with that, in 2004, all these countries joined the European Union. So let's say in this sense, she couldn't say anymore, it's because we should wait for the others before we go ahead. Yeah, I'm coming to a certain end after giving you certain impressions. One was the point of how do we define narratives. We got some examples of Coimbra Group. What is the narrative of a Coimbra Group? The narrative of our university here. We looked at certain definitions. And as I said, in social science, we have different ways of dealing with these ambiguities. But I think the term of mental maps and also master narratives, I think, is quite important, and we should stick and stay with that. I think that's a very important part to study that. And then my starting point is we need to look how far this European Union is based on some kind of joint or shared narratives, and do we see divergences between these narratives, also with the European Union of 27. Again, the history of Poland and the history of Portugal looks quite different. Over the last centuries, where do they find common points or not? And is the European Union Treaty, as I showed by certain articles, is that, that's a point of orientation? Does this indicate there is some kind of basic fundamental narrative in this European Union? So we will find out in our lectures here, which Herr Müller indicated will come, is there more divergences or more convergences? Where are there common points? What is surprisingly in common with all the different histories of these people, of these peoples in Europe, of these nations in Europe? And what are convergences? For example, looking that if you look from the East River, that's the United Nations headquarters, if you look on the world, you will find much more common points on Europe than if you just start looking from Berlin or from Paris on Europe. You find more differences. So where are we looking from? What are our perspectives? And perhaps, Herr Müller, the question mark might be solved at the end of this lecture series. So till then, I wish you much fun and much enjoyment, and hopefully this kind of development of our debate into some kind of grand débat européen, as the French would say. Thank you very much.